Hello and welcome to today's online service. We begin with these most familiar words from the 23rd Psalm, and this is in the King James Version. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Let us pray. Risen Christ, faithful shepherd of your Father's sheep, teach us to hear your voice and to follow your command, that all your people may be gathered into one flock, to the glory of God the Father. Amen.
In today's scripture, we read about Jesus' triumph over death. Let's start with Acts, chapter 9. In Joppa, there was a disciple named Tabitha, in Greek, Dorcas, meaning gazelle, who filled her days with acts of kindness and charity. At that time, she fell ill and died, and they washed her body and laid it in a room upstairs. As Lydda was near Joppa, the disciples, who had heard that Peter was there, sent two men to him with the urgent request, "Please come over to us without delay." At once, Peter went off with them. When he arrived, he was taken up to the room, and all the widows came and stood round him in tears, showing him the shirts and coats that Dorcas used to make while she was still with them. Peter sent them all outside and knelt down and prayed. Then, turning toward the body, he said, "Tabitha, get up." She opened her eyes, saw Peter, and sat up. He gave her his hand and helped her to her feet. Then he called together the members of the church and the widows and showed her to them alive. News of it spread all over Joppa, and many came to believe in the Lord. Peter stayed on in Joppa for some time at the house of a tanner named Simon. Our gospel reading for today is from the 10th chapter of John. It was winter, and the festival of the dedication was being held in Jerusalem. As Jesus was walking in the temple precincts in Solomon's portico, the Jews gathered round him and asked, "How long are you going to keep us in suspense? Tell us plainly, are you the Messiah?" "I have told you," said Jesus, "and you do not believe. My deeds done in my Father's name are my credentials. But because you are not sheep of my flock, you do not believe. My own sheep listen to my voice. I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they will never perish. No one will snatch them from my care. My Father, who has given them to me, is greater than all, and no one can snatch them out of the Father's care. The Father and I are one." The word of God for the people of God. Be safe.
If I asked you to define your relationship with God, how would you do it? What might you say? In short, what makes a person a Christian? It's a tremendously important question, isn't it? Something that we all need to get clear in our minds. You see, we could be deeply religious and yet not have a true relationship with God. You could be an avid churchgoer and yet completely misunderstand the distinguishing marks of genuine Christianity. And so it's something we must face, something that we shouldn't ignore. The question, am I a Christian, is one of the most important that we could ever ask. And nobody should leave here today, virtually, I guess, with at least the beginnings, I suggest, of an honest answer to that question. Well, John in John chapter 10 is of great help with this question. Here's one of the best known passages in the entire Bible in which Jesus calls himself the Good Shepherd. He also calls himself the Gate. Beautiful pictures of authentic Christianity, of the real thing. And I think that's what we all want. We want the real thing expressed by Jesus. And here we have, through John's gospel, Christ's final public address, in which the Apostle John records for us. And I wanted to just suggest five marks or five features of authentic Christianity that we could draw from the text. And the first is this: intimacy. Intimacy. The true Christian man or woman has entered into a relationship with God, which is best described as an intimate friendship. God as shepherd. You know, when David in the Psalms talked of the great Jehovah as my shepherd, like what we read in Psalm 23, when David equated God as the shepherd of his sheep, it was just as startling in his day as it would be later when Christ talked about God as Abba, God as daddy, God as father. Suddenly it's become personal, it's become intimate, it's become family. And that Old Testament background would have not been lost on Jesus' listeners here. Here you see was as relevant a metaphor as you could possibly get in a pastoral society where virtually every family kept a few sheep at the very least. There would also have been parallels for Jesus' listeners of the downside of this picture of the Old Testament shepherd. You know, the false shepherds of Ezekiel 34, of Isaiah 56, of Jeremiah, and other places. Those are Israel's former leaders who let their people down, those leaders who failed to care for them or nurture them, the leaders who looked out only for themselves, who put themselves first and not their flock. So we should note that in Jesus, we have the fulfillment of that Old Testament promise to appoint a new shepherd. This was heralded and suggested by King David, and now this shepherd is completed in King Jesus. Well, what is a good shepherd? I always have this romantic idea of sheep herding, you know, wellies and tweed caps and all that stuff, plus fours. But, you know, the more I read about sheep, it's probably not the as exciting or maybe as romantic job as I might say. I found out sheep are very easily frightened. They're defenseless against predators. They'll follow anyone or anything without a clue where they're headed. If they're not following other sheep, then there's this natural tendency to wander aimlessly until they're so hungry, so dehydrated, and so lost that they simply will lay down and die. And if a sheep should injure, say, a leg in a hole or something, well, there's little that the creature could do but to stay where they are in hopes that the shepherd will be aware of their absence. Sheep are definitely not the brightest of God's creation. They're basically helpless. I'm beginning to think that when God refers to us as his sheep, this may not be, in fact, a great compliment. But in first century Palestine, this was an intimate affair. Sheep were kept mainly for wool and not for food, so they tended to be around the family for most of their lives. They were generally kept in small numbers. A typical flock would be somewhere between 20 to 30 head, and the shepherd would know them and regard them almost as pets. I suppose that they'd be given names based on what they looked like, Spot or Long Ears or White Nose, something like that. Now, to even lose one sheep was an economic blow. Every single sheep in your flock counted. And each town and village had what is described, chapter 10, verse 1, the sheepfold by the gate. It was secured walls with a gate under the control of a night watchman, I'd say. And then the owners would put their sheep in there at night before retiring, and then they'd come and pick them up in the morning. And then what would have happened is that the shepherd would come to the gate. Verse 3, the gatekeeper opens the gate for them, and the sheep hear his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. It's a charming picture, isn't it? Verse 4. When he has brought out all of his own, he goes ahead of them, and the sheep follow him because they know his voice. They know his voice. Verse 14, Jesus says, I am the good shepherd. I know my own, and my own know me. And he leads them out. There's a recognition here. What a beautiful picture of the true relationship between God and his children. They hear his voice. He calls them by name, and he says, follow me. And they do. I'm known personally, intimately loved by God, the good shepherd. I'm precious, and I'm important to him, and so are you. And that's extraordinary in a way, isn't it? It's humbling considering how much we ignore God, how much we keep him in our back pocket or on the peripheries of our lives. I mean, do we know anything about this intimacy? It's the first mark of authentic Christianity. It's intimacy. You see, when Christ sees our congregation, whether that's online or in one of our three churches, he doesn't see people as we see people. I mean, in a congregation, a church, we know some people. There's some people we don't know. There's some people we care for. There's other people we know nothing about. But he knows all of us, and he knows all about us. And he wants to call us quite simply into friendship with him. And the Creator knows me by name. It's moving, isn't it? Human beings, we were created for intimacy, to know and to be known, to love and to be loved. We're hungry for closeness with other people. But above all, aren't we hungry for closeness with God? And here's the good shepherd showing that this is all possible. You see, there are some who view God a bit like the Queen of England. They see him as a distance. You know, they may even hold him in high regard, respect the office, way from the back of the crowd, content in showing their respect and his life story. But you know, what Jesus wants is not observers or acquaintances. He wants friends. And would you describe honestly what you've got going on between you and God in these following categories? Are you on speaking terms, in regular friendship, intimate in love, never alone, always cared for, known by name, never being abandoned or let down? I mean, you know, it's the best part about being a Christian. Well, our second mark of the authentic Christian is direction. Again, verse 3, the gatekeeper opens the gate for him, and the sheep hear his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When the shepherd calls out his own sheep by name, he leads them out, and his sheep follow him because they know his voice. Verse 5, they will not follow a stranger, but they will run from him because they do not know the voice of strangers. And this is part of our second proposition. The authentic Christian follows Jesus in obedience. You know, none of us want to live without direction any more than we want to live without intimacy. And the source in each case is the same. It's Jesus. Who do you consider to be your life authority? How do you make decisions? How do you decide what is right and what is wrong? How do you sort out what life is really about? Who's in charge of your life? Is it someone else or is it Jesus? Again, at one level, it's not very flattering to be compared to sheep, mindless and helpless at times, but it really is a fair picture. It's a fair picture of fallen humanity, that we do need someone to shepherd us. We need the shepherding of Jesus, and he so graciously provides it, doesn't he? And so the question in every situation for the Christian becomes, how can I honor Christ here? And suddenly, with that question, how could I honor Christ? We're not shackled to codes of conduct anymore, to lists of rules, the way that the Pharisee in Jesus' times were. We're responsible to a person. We're responsible to Jesus himself. And our motivation for this is not some sort of stiff upper lip, sense of duty. Our motivation is the gratitude of those who have been saved and set free by Jesus Christ. But of course, it's not always straightforward, is it? There were as many distractions back when John was writing this as there are today. There are just as many competing voices. There's different things pressing in on us, calling away from that single-minded following of Jesus. The competing voices of strangers, the thieves and the robbers, verses 1, verses 8. Metaphorically speaking, those thieves and robbers are with us today. The same people offering today as they offered back then. They offered the political solution, the materialistic solution, the sexual solution, the violent solution. They are the offers of the extremists, the cults, the con men, the New Age guru in one form or the other. And they all offer freedom, which ultimately is illusory, and which always ends in destruction and disappointment. No, you see, there's only one way, says Jesus, one gate for the sheep, verse 7, one source of direction, one route which delivers the liberation it promises in the life that we long for. And that route is in Christ. He is the gate. And the authentic Christian finds himself asking among all these competing voices, am I committed to going this one way and listening to this one voice and obeying this one Lord? Well, is that you? Can you say, yes, I know intimacy. I have entered friendship with God. And secondly, I have direction because I recognize Jesus as Lord. Am I committed to going his way? The third mark of the true Christian is found in verse 10. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they may have life and have it abundantly. I have come, it says in other translations. Wonderful words, aren't they? I have come, says Jesus, that they may have life and have a full life, have an abundant life. The third mark of a Christian is fulfillment. I mean, how many of our friends and our contemporaries have rejected Christianity not because they're convinced it's untrue, but simply because they've been given this distinct impression that somehow Christianity is dull and restrictive, that somehow our life will be narrow and less enjoyable when we become Christian. You know, that when you become a Christian, Jesus just shuts you in. He limits your freedom and takes all the fun away. Well, of course, that's a lie. Jesus says exactly the opposite, doesn't he? Now, it's not easy, as believers know. This isn't sort of health and wealth and never any other problems sort of stuff. Being a Christian isn't the end of our problems or pressures, of course not. But there's an unmistakable shift in our perspective and in our experiences. When someone turns to Christ, the colors of life are sharper, the joys are deeper, the sorrows are somehow more manageable, the relationships are richer. You know, I could remember myself coming to Christ, and almost immediately, almost at once, things like the countryside seemed more beautiful. The city began to feel less oppressive. My studies began to seem more purposeful. There was a sharpness and a focus, a pleasure. I guess that's one word, pleasure. Pleasure that hadn't been there before. And that's how it works. That's authentic Christianity. And what's even greater than that, what begins now will be perfectly consummated in heaven. We think about heaven. Have we thought about that lately? Take the deepest enchantment you had in your life that you've ever known. Take the greatest ecstasy you ever felt in your life. Take the greatest fulfillment you've ever experienced. Take that moment when you felt most alive in your whole existence and intensify that moment by a million times. And maybe then you begin to imagine just something of what heaven will be like. Make no mistake, Jesus promises and guarantees life to the full here on earth for those who follow him, and joy unthinkable in the next world. Again, is this you? Have you tasted yet to any degree the God factor of enjoyment for yourself? The chief end of man is to glorify God and enjoy him forever. Are we enjoying God? The fourth mark of real Christianity is security. The first mark is intimate relations, relationship to Jesus as friend. The second mark is direction, submitting to Jesus as Lord. The third mark is fulfillment, a life energized by the indwelling of the Spirit of Jesus. Then the fourth mark is the security guaranteed by Jesus as Savior. It's where, in verse 9, whoever enters by me will be saved and will come in and go out and find pasture. This security is further developed in verse 11. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. And perhaps that's the first takeaway that we should meditate on. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. And we tend to over-sentimentalize the shepherd picture, you know, the sort of tanned, handsome, bearded chap with a crook and a cuddly lamb over his arms. But first century shepherding was hard. It was dusty, dirty, sweaty, dangerous work. Sacrifices had to be made. And that would have resonated with Jesus' listeners. And another thing which would have resonated with his listeners is when Jesus talked of himself as the good shepherd, they wouldn't have missed that messianic significance. And this is why his listeners get so flustered as they do later on in this chapter. If Jesus said, I'm the shepherd, I've come to redeem Israel, to lead Israel to freedom, then nobody would have minded. Nobody would have batted an eyelid. But he didn't. He linked this messianic theme to his death, to the shepherd dying. And that was strange. That set off alarm bells. It just didn't seem right. But the messiahship of Jesus was altogether different. unlike those imposters who came before him, those violent charlatans whose rebellions have cost them and their followers their lives, unlike those hucksters, Jesus was going to give his life for others. The death of Jesus was a loving, moving, committed sacrifice. Jesus' death was a loving death. And that's the point, you see, of the contrast with the hired hand of verses 12 and 13. The hired hand, who is not the shepherd and does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and runs away. And the wolf snatches them and scatters them. The hired hand runs away because a hired hand does not care for the sheep. The problem with the hired hand is that he really doesn't care. It really doesn't matter. He's not connected to the sheep. But Jesus is altogether different. Jesus is concerned, profoundly concerned, with our ultimate safety and security. It's why he came. It's why he died. But Jesus' death is not only a loving death, but it's also a planned death. Verse 18, "No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it up again." Do you see that? No one takes my life away from me. There's no surprise here for Jesus. He's not the victim of circumstance. No, he does what he does because he does it in obedience to the Father's purpose for the salvation of the world. Look at verse 17. "For this reason the Father loves me, because I lay down my life in order to take it up again." The reason that the Father loves me is I lay down my life and then glancing ahead to the resurrection only to take it up again. But the most significant thing about all this, verses 1 and 11 and 15, it's not only a loving death, it's not only a planned death, but supremely it's a saving death. It's for the sheep. And if you're a sheep, being saved is only necessary if you're in some sort of danger. And part of the problem for so many people today in understanding why Jesus had to die is because there's no sense of being in danger. There's no recognition of danger. There's no recognition that as human beings, we are, in fact, eternal beings. You see, we could reject the friendship of God. We could decide to go our own way in our own direction. You can make do with the life you have. Many have. But all those things have consequences. All of us will die. And we will all face God in judgment. I mean, whether we like this idea or not, whether we're Christian or we're not, whether we're atheists, agnostics, Buddhists, nudists, it doesn't matter. We will all have to face God in judgment. Again, verse 12, "The hired hand who is not the shepherd and does not own the sheep sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and runs away. And the wolf snatches them and scatters them." The wolf is coming. And that's serious. It's serious enough for God to send his son to die for our protection. I mean, if you're a parent, for example, could you think of anything so significant that you would let your child die for it? I mean, it would have to be something of great consequence, wouldn't it? It's that serious. You know, in our human flock, we're a bit like sheep. We dash around in futile panic in the face of death and judgment. And when what we need is a relationship with the good shepherd, the kind of shepherd who could take death away from us, who could bear it on himself. We can't do it for ourselves, but he could do it for us. And he can and he does something really big. The death of Jesus, the Son of God, the Lamb of God, the Good Shepherd, dies so that you and I could be rescued. And that's what it comes to. And that's the promise of verses 28 and 29. "I gave them eternal life, and they will never perish. No one will snatch them out of my hands. My Father, in regard to what he has given to me, is greater than all, and no one can snatch them out of the Father's hand." You see, those words hardly be clearer. So here's the fourth test of authentic Christianity. Ask yourself, could I say, making this entirely personal, could I say that my sins are forgiven and I have experienced the rescue of Jesus who has died for me? Let's just go through that checklist so far. Intimacy in God's friendship, yes. Direction under Christ's lordship, yes. Fulfillment by Christ's spirit, yes. Eternal security through Christ's death, yes. And now the fifth mark and the final mark of the authentic Christian, unity with all of God's people. And it's right there in verse 16. "I have other sheep that did not belong to this fold. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice. So there will be one flock, one shepherd." You see, in that verse, it's not just the sheep that are in the pen, but it's all sheep. "I have other sheep that do not belong to this fold." Jesus says at the end of the verse, there will be one flock and one shepherd. And here we have a clear vision beyond Israel to the Gentile church, to us, the millions of people who have heard his voice and through his sacrificial death have been drawn into the life and the vitality of his kingdom. Well, if you find yourself unexcited by, unmoved by, unaffected by the privilege of being part of this multicultural, multi-ethnic, worldwide family of Jesus Christ and the church, then it may be that you have yet to discover authentic Christianity. Well, as we close today, please reflect on this checklist that's based on the Good Shepherd passage. Will you ask yourself again and again until you are clear in your own mind the questions we have asked? Intimacy. Do you see a relationship with God who knows you by name as one intimate friendship? Secondly, direction. Have you resolved to make your obedience to Christ, obedience to the Good Shepherd's voice? Have you resolved to make this your life's direction? Question number three, fulfillment. Have you begun to experience the personal fulfillment produced uniquely by Christ's Spirit working within you? There's number four, security. Are you sure that your sins have been forgiven by Christ, the Good Shepherd who laid down his life for you? And finally, unity. Are you excited to be a full member of the one worldwide flock of Jesus Christ? Well, those are the questions. Answer those questions positively, and you could say, I certainly am a Christian. But honestly, if honestly you find that some of the questions are difficult, or you find that you're still not connecting with them, then there may be more thinking to do, more praying to do, more discussion. And you need to take the opportunity to think about it and talk about it further. The issues are simply too important to let drift by. And I tell you, within our congregations, the more small groups or class meetings we have, the more that we participate in, the more opportunity we have to answer these questions ourselves, or the opportunity in helping others answer those questions. And so I just want to leave you with this prayer. Here's our prayer for today. Heavenly Father, I want to come into relationship. I want to come into friendship with you. I want you to be my shepherd, so please lead me. Lord Jesus, thank you for dying for me, for dying on the cross, and please forgive me. Heavenly Father, I want to come in relationship with all your sheep, so please help guide our church. Lord Jesus, I want you to be my shepherd. Amen. Mm-hmm.